So I love to ask medical students, psychiatry residents, even fellow doctors, the simplest of questions, but you know, we all know that the simplest of questions is often the hardest of questions. So I'll say, what are the functions, plural, of sleep? And usually just putting the plural on it kind of stuns most people. So medical students will often give me the kind of deer in headlights, and they'll say, well, the function of sleep is to rest. Of course, you say, well, could we actually make that into a sentence, perhaps, instead of just a single word? But it's just so elegant, so ingenious, so brilliant what the Creator has designed for us mere mortals with sleep, because it's not simply to rest. Number one, as you can see, it's energy conservation. So, you know, if you think of ourselves for just a minute as a machine, it's generally not good for machines to continuously run. And going back to the disc jockeys that are not getting any sleep, after a while, energy conservation really wears thin and bad things happen. But wait, there's more. And this is, by the way, all these pieces are now evidence-based and documented. We know that when we intentionally sleep-deprive college students, after 2 or 3 days, we can look at their immune system and see that it's beginning to tumble and that they're much more likely to acquire viral illness or bacterial illness. So somehow, some way, magically, mysteriously, during sleep, our immune system reboots. But wait, there is more. This is like an infomercial. When we sleep, and this is easily measured, lots of evidence, there's hormonal restoration. So this is when our body reboots hormonally, particularly, as I mentioned earlier, human growth hormone, which, again, to reinforce, has a lot to do with cellular aging and cellular repair. So if that's damaged or slowed down, we're going to see cellular repair diminished and cellular aging accelerated. And then the last one, very near and dear to my heart as a psychiatrist, is memory consolidation. So every day we have billions, maybe trillions, of bits of information coming our way. The vast majority is noise, and we have to kind of sort out what's important, what do we want to keep in short-term storage, long-term storage, what will help us survive. And there's, again, good evidence, you know, taking college students and sleep depriving them and asking them to do memory functions, we just see them perform awful. So we think sleep has a lot to do with memory consolidation. But the most exciting thing, absolutely the most exciting thing, and this is very new, as you can see, Science 2013. So we know about the lymphatic system in our body. It's from the neck down. And what the lymphatic system does is it sort of parallels blood vessels and veins, and it removes waste products. Brilliant. Quite fascinating, there's no lymphatic system in our brain, this enclosed capsule that weighs 3 pounds and takes up 25% of the energy requirements of our body every second of the day. So this very recent finding that in our brain there's something called a glymphatic system. And the short story is this is actually built into the cerebral spinal fluid. And during the day when we're awake, the CSF is relatively inactive, relatively slow moving. But at night when we sleep, the CSF switches over into a far faster paced, far broader spectrum of coverage. And we think that that is the built-in lymphatic system, if you will, of our brain. But wait, there's more. There's now evidence that the glymphatic system perhaps has a lot to do with clearance of beta amyloid plaque production. So one of the potential targets in terms of Alzheimer's research is there any way to perhaps amplify this glymphatic system that appears as we age to be less robust? So this is a new finding, stay tuned. But exciting finding that here's a clearance system for waste products in the brain that may actually have some benefit in terms of dementia. And then the last little bullet, there's a movement afoot, mostly from the folks that study sleep. As sleep deserves to be studied, we spend a third of our life in it. And when I went to medical school, in my 4 years of medical school, we got 1 hour on sleep. And I think I got 70 hours on the Krebs cycle, and I'm waiting to use the Krebs cycle any day now, where I always ask all my patients about sleep. So back on track, there's a movement afoot now, driven by sleep specialists, that maybe sleep should be the fifth vital sign, or certainly should be a very early part of inquiry on any exam. You know, how well do you sleep? What time do you go to sleep? What time do you wake up? Is it restful? Is it restorative? So we'll see what time will tell, but I hope I'm highlighting the incredible importance and the multiple functions of sleep that we don't really consider until we start to think about it.